powerful person home and gives him a dinner, and at the end of the dinner hands him over a packet containing some money. His wife observes all that, and when the guest is gone, she takes him to task. She says, I couldn't even imagine you could stoop to such low levels. What has happened to you? मैं तो सोच भी नहीं सकती थी तुम इतना नीचे गिर सकते हो, क्या हो गया तुम्हें? एंड आर हीरो रिप्लाइज, देखो ये दुनिया मैंने नहीं बनाई, मैं सिर्फ इस दुनिया में रहता हूँ और यहाँ जीने के लिए जो कुछ करना पड़ता है वो सब करता हूँ, और ये सब मैं किसके लिए कर रहा हूँ? तुम्हारे और मुन्ने के लिए ही तो कर रहा हूँ. नाउ व्हाट्स हैपनिंग हियर इज दैट देयर आर a number of tools that we can see are at work. The person has the choice of being corrupt or not being corrupt. He feels like living a physically comfortable life, and the decision to be corrupt is based on that, which means that the decision is guided by feelings. So feelings are one tool that we have, the emotional part of the being. But then when he has been taken to task, he is trying to justify what he is doing using the second tool, and that is the intellect, which works on the basis of reason. So he is giving a few reasons why he is doing it. He is doing it because he happens to live in the world, which it is not his fault that it has been created the way it has been, and it is all essential for survival in this world. So he's justifying what he's doing. Then, you know, he's trying to encourage his wife also to think in the same way by stimulating her emotions and saying, ye sab main tumhare aur munne ke liye hi to kar raha hu. I'm doing it all for your sake and for the sake of the child. So he's encouraging her to also use her intellect in the same way. Now, intellect, which works on the basis of reason, is something that we place on a very high pedestal. And we feel it can save us from all evil, all wrongdoing. It can give us the best decisions. And that, in fact, is its legitimate function, so that we don't get carried away by emotions. But then what happens very often is that the emotions can become so powerful that they can exploit the intellect, which means that instead of the intellect moderating and governing the feelings end up compelling the intellect to invent reasons which would justify what we want at the emotional level. So that is exploitation of the intellect by the feelings, so that now the intellect starts inventing those reasons which would justify what we want at the emotional level. So that is what he is doing. He has found reasons to justify what he is doing. But then while he has done something because he felt like doing it, and he has been able to use the intellect to justify it also, so some sort of an understanding or harmony has been reached between the emotional part of the being and the intellect. While he has been able to achieve that harmony and he's feeling very clever that, see, I have been able to justify myself, there is some faint whisper somewhere deep within which is still telling him, she is right, you are wrong. Now, if the feelings and the intellect have achieved some sort of an understanding with each other, then where is this dissenting voice coming from? Where is this voice coming from that says, she is right and you are wrong? This is a voice that is faint, but at the same time it is extremely clear, and it is not going into any arguments. Without going into any arguments, it is still able to say very clearly and tell him that he is wrong, she is right. So in other words, what we have seen through this example is that going towards the goal of life depends upon making choices, and for making choices we have three tools available: our feelings, the capacity to reason, and an inner voice that comes from somewhere deep within. And as you might have guessed, going towards the goal depends upon acting upon this inner voice. And therefore, it's important to understand some of the characteristics of the inner voice. We saw that this voice is rather shy and faint and non-assertive, but at the same time, it is extremely clear. Once we hear it, we are left with no doubts, we are left with no questions about what the right thing to do is. And that is because it is a part of our divine essence, and the divine knows all, and once everything is known, then the crutch of reasoning is not necessary. Further, if the person decides to respond to this voice, the person also acquires the courage to act upon it. Because the divine is not only all-knowing, it is also all-powerful. And therefore, the person acquires the courage to act upon this voice. But all the same, this is a type of voice that will guide us to choices which may involve losing something. In this particular case, the person is losing the money, the wealth that he is able to make by being corrupt. There can be other situations in which we lose time. For example, you find a person injured on the road, take this person to the hospital. The impulse to take the person to the hospital comes from the same inner voice. The person loses a few hours of time. So we end up losing an object, some money, time, whatever. So it involves losing in the sense it involves giving. These are choices which are based on giving, and giving means in terms of material terms or in concrete terms which can be measured, we are losing something. Why is it that the person, in spite of losing something, ends up listening to this voice or takes a risk? It may involve a risk, and yet the person enjoys taking that risk. For example, there is a burning building and a firefighter enters the burning building to rescue a few people. Again, this impulse to enter the burning building to rescue people comes from that same inner voice. And if we were to use the intellect and wait before acting on this impulse, he might be told, well, I don't want to enter the building because it's very risky. And my own family is waiting back home, what will happen to them? But all the same, he does take this risk and enters so often. So why is it that the person takes a risk or loses something when he responds to this voice? It's because the person can anticipate that if I listen to this voice, in spite of losing something, I'll get immense joy. And even more important than joy, I'll get lasting mental peace. On the other hand, if I do not enter this or building, or for that matter, I do not respond to this voice, I'll feel guilty and I'll get recurrent uneasiness, which means repeatedly, I would keep feeling I knew what the right thing to do was, but I didn't do it. So the joy and the lasting mental peace are the reward that come from letting this voice prevail, and a sense of guilt and recurrent uneasiness is the punishment for not responding to this voice. So this is a voice that not only provides us quick guidance, because it's not a time-consuming process. It, in an instant, it tells us what the right thing to do is. Unlike reason, which is a time-consuming, laborious process involving a lot of analysis. So this quick tool, which in an instant tells us what the right thing to do is not only a guide towards the best choices in life, it also is coupled with an inbuilt reward and punishment system. And this is something important to realize, because a lot of crime thrives in the society because the person feels that I'm committing the crime so cleverly that I'll never be found out. And the fact is that very often it does work out that way, because the amount of crime that is committed in a society is much more than the crime that is detected. And the crime that is punished is only a small fraction of even the crime that is detected. So the fact is that the person is able to get away. So if the fear is only that of external punishment, which will come from outside, the person can very often escape. But here this is a punishment coming from inside, and this is a punishment nobody can escape. And it is because the person can anticipate that I will not be able to escape this punishment, that very often the person does end up acting on this voice. Now, to be sure which tool out of these three will take the person towards the destination of life, one should understand the destination itself. But due to lack of time, we will not go into that in detail. Although you will be able to guess it by the end of the session, and but all the same, what is important is that if somebody tells us that you can go towards the goal of life by using this particular tool, the tool of this inner voice that speaks to us in this extremely clear, although faint voice, one can say that, well, it may take us somewhere, but then why should they accept wherever it takes us as the goal of my life? My life, my business. Certainly, this is not the type of choices that will take me towards the goal of becoming a very wealthy and successful person. That is not the type of goal which I can reach by making these choices. And if that is my goal, then my life is my business. To understand that, let's see what all we get by making these choices. We already saw that we get by making these choices two things: immense joy and lasting mental peace. Now, joy is a type of happiness. Happiness, is, broadly speaking, is of two types. The happiness that comes from getting something, for example, getting a new dress or getting something nice to eat, and the happiness that comes from giving something. One is happy when one gets a new dress. One is also happy when one gives clothes in charity. So there's a joy associated with giving. And out of the two, the joy of giving feels better. So we get from making these choices not only happiness, but happiness of a superior type, a superior version of happiness. And that is why we call it joy rather than just happiness. And even more important than that, we get lasting mental peace, because that is something that we want even more than just happiness. Is there anything else that we get? We get control over our well-being, because getting is not always in our own hands, giving always is. We can't force somebody to love us, but we can always love somebody. Nobody can stop us from doing that. So this is something which we always have in our own hands, and we do want control over our sense of happiness. Another thing that we get by making these choices is absence of conflict in life. Conflict between what? Conflict between the three tools that we have for making choices in life: the emotional part of the being, the intellect, and this inner voice. They are often in conflict, and gradually what happens by listening to this voice is that this conflict goes down. Now, if there's a conflict between three entities, how can this conflict go? There are two ways in which it can happen.